time for another edition of Live from Studio M on 105.5 Triple M. I'm your host, Jonathan Sutton. And when we hear music, a lot of times we try to identify with that band, with like some other sound. Those guys sound just like, or she reminds me of. But what's so great is when you get a band and you're like, who the hell do they sound like? They don't sound like anybody I know. And that makes it really exciting. And that's what we get with today's band. We'll talk to them about that. Lots of interesting stories that they have from the road. But first, let's hear a song from Judah and the Line, live from Studio M.
What's up? So, a little bit about us. We kind of started...
Oh, dude, I'm going to ask all these questions.
We don't want an intro for the song.
We just want you to...
let's just play.
Just let's play it, baby.
I always like setting it up so well, I like the song better, but...
Well, if you want... Right,
here's the first song.
Okay. All right, sorry. Is Judah and the Lion, and man, I bet there's a great story with that song.
Since I was such a dick at the beginning, I'm sorry about that. I was like freaked out. We had Lucas Graham here a few weeks ago, and he just like took over, so I got nervous. So why don't you tell us the story related to that? I'm sorry.
No. I was just gonna say we tend to talk a lot when it's kind of the intimate crowd. This is kind of the way we grew up as like our touring band. We would pretty much email anybody that would feed us and let us play music in their house to invite their friends over. So that's kind of the way we kind of started as a band. So this is very kind of comfortable for us, and I always kind of end up to talking way too much, sure. Like what you said. It's probably a good thing you shut me up, actually. But no, last year I just had this like pretty emotional roller coaster of a year, 2016. My grandpa, who I was really close with, passed away. And then like a month after that, my first nephew ever was born. And I don't know, just like that was kind of like a reflection on just kind of like where I'm at now with life and where we're kind of going and what matters the most and stuff like that.
For sure. Now, I read that some musicians, they sit down and write every day. You're not the type who does that, right? It kind of what strikes you when you write, or do you print it out?
I mean, I feel like a lot of us, we're kind of a little bit different in where we operate. But for me, yeah, it's just inspiration. I don't really do well when it's just kind of like methodical and just practical. I've never been that kind of like Bob Dylan writer where you just kind of write every day and right. It just works.
Yeah, absolutely. We got a lot of wanting to hear the origins of the band and stuff, but Judah, I want to ask you first though, because I saw this and I didn't know if it was true or not, about your parents. Their music was very different from each other. Is that really true? And it like depended who you were driving with in the car?
Yeah.
What's that sort of?
Yeah, well, my dad was very into sports, and me and my dad were kind of had about this relationship where he was kind of always my coach, and I kind of grew up as a jock. And so whenever we would get into his car, he would be having like 50 Cent, like Eminem, Tribe Called Quest, Run DMC, Beastie Boys, that type of alley. And then my mom was more of like the critically acclaimed like rockers like Tom Petty, Queen, Elton John, R.E.O. Speedwagon, R.E.M., those type of guys. So yeah, I like both. I love the vibe of just getting my dad's car and like dancing around with all my athletic friends, and then getting my mom's car and singing every song, every Queen, like the Bohemian Rhapsody, passenger seat. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And you were saying about being a jock. You went to school for baseball, right?
I did. Yeah.
What position?
I was a middle infielder in high school, and then I was first baseman pretty much all 4 years at Belmont.
Okay, so now everybody else in the band, you guys are not jocks, are you? I mean, maybe one.
We're all on the team.
No,
this
but
is a baseball band.
So yeah, baseball band, exactly. So did you with the formation of the band? Then I mean, are you three guys more pure musicians, and it was like, who's this jock, or I don't know who wants to address that?
I always wanted to be a jock.
Me too.
I wanted to be a hockey player, but my parents gave me a guitar instead.
Okay.
I guess that worked out okay.
Yeah, absolutely. And how did you guys, like, how did it happen? If you can tell us a little the origin.
We all met at Belmont University, and Brian, the other player, and I were music majors. Studied guitar there, and both got these instruments kind of early on in college, and no one was playing these. No one was studying these instruments in Nashville, surprisingly. There's like a couple hundred guitar majors, but no banjo or mandolin major. And so we both kind of saw this niche area to hop into.
Did one of you was the first to major in?
Both of us, actually.
Were the first to major
in our respective instruments.
Wow.
But neither was finished, so I don't know if it counts. And then Spencer played music at school, but he studied social entrepreneurship. Is that right?
That's right.
That is. And all of us kind of knew each other through different groups and all that. I guess Brian and I played together at school.
How did the jock end?
Judah heard about me. How did you hear about me?
So, well, Nate had the beard before beards, like, were cool. I'm sure maybe in Wisconsin, beards were always cool. But in Nashville, like, it wasn't, like, a hipster for you to have a beard, like, until, like, the last few years. But Nate was always this kind of this, like, weird icon at Belmont. Like, he's a very kind person, so, like, everybody loved talking to Nate. But then he was also this kind of, like, character with a beard. And so my roommate at the time knew Nate and knew that he played banjo, and I was like trying to write these songs that I wanted to fit more of that Tom Petty lean, the kind of like the rock, the watch guitar, bass, and then it just wasn't working, the songs that I was writing. I don't know, kind of like a writer, you want to have this like certain feeling when you hear your songs, and I just wasn't, for whatever reason, like having that moment. And then I was like, you know what, I should try these songs with like more organic music, because I'm from kind of a redneck town in Tennessee, and so banjos and mandolins are actually pretty common. So it's like, I didn't kind of go back to like where I'm from, my roots, I guess, and then played through these songs the first time with these guys after calling Nate, and it just felt right.
Interesting. And Nate, your parents are classically trained, right? Are they in the symphony? Or?
Yep, in Colorado Springs.
So what do they play?
Mom plays piano and Dad plays trumpet.
Okay, but they gave you a banjo?
I started on those instruments and then saw School of Rock in sixth grade. I was the same age as those kids, and I was like, I want to do that. They got me a guitar around Christmas.
That's awesome. That's awesome. All right, well, let's hear another song. And if you have a story for the song, I'll be quiet. let you tell us. What are you going to do for it?
No, we got the tour randomly over in Scandinavia the last year and a half. And the first time we went over there was in the middle of winter, and if you know anything about Scandinavia, it's a lot like Australia. It's very seasonally based as far as when the sun comes out. And so like in the winter when we were over there, we did 24 dates, 24 shows in like 26 days, and it was just kind of like an insane schedule. And the sun like came out like twice. And so we were kind of, I don't know, when the sun doesn't come out, and we see it a little bit here probably in the winter when it, you know, kind of dreary all the time, but when it literally doesn't only come, it only comes out if you're lucky like 1 hour of the day, you can just kind of feel it. And they were like, you gotta come back in the summer. So we ended up coming back in the summer and doing like the opposite. We did like 5 shows in like 2.5 weeks. So we didn't have that big of a like show schedule. And the sun like sets at midnight and then comes like right back up. And people were just happy and like walking their babies by the river, drinking a beer like at midnight at night. Like, I mean, it's insane, the culture. So we just really fell in love with Sweden, our second family over there, and we wrote a song about Stockholm.
It's Judah and the Lion from Studio One.
I just got to Stockholm, and I'm walking on the stones. It's the middle of July, and I don't know if I'll ever make it home. If I'll ever make it home. Made it down to Old Town, churches and shadow. Got no plans, but I'm never going home. Oh, I'm never going home. I'm not ready for this. Summer day, I'm staying inside.
Some
not ready for this.
Absolutely. Now, let's see, there's a couple other things that wanted to cover. One of them was, and I don't know if this was an awkward interview that I found from years ago, but I feel like it was one of your mom's friends or something. Her name was Becky Magura.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it was actually a pretty sweet interview, but with that, I feel like, who was that person?
So actually, I was one of my close friends from high school who has this local channel, like the WCTE channel at like our upper Cumberland area in my hometown of Tennessee. So yeah, that was kind of a treat to be able to do that. It made my grandma really happy.
Yeah, it seemed like a very...
I'm really surprised that you watched that though.
Really all 26 minutes. Of, all 26 minutes.
Oh, my gosh.
But it was pretty funny. It was sweet.
Thank you. It was awesome. Probably really funny.
Now you're married. Is anybody else in the band?
I just got
married. You just got married?
Yeah, last week and a half.
Yeah. Did you say a week and a half?
Week and a half ago, yeah.
All right, so did you like all play at the wedding? Or?
No, we couldn't go.
It was sad. We were on tour. We had to come back home.
Oh, really?
Couldn't miss the show.
Wow.
Yeah, it was rough.
It was pretty rough, yeah. But.
All right, super awkward. I should not ask questions that I don't know the answer to. Okay.
Yeah, don't bring that up.
Yeah. All right. Do you guys talk to your wives about the songs? Like, hey, is this a good one? Or is it everything you guys write, it's all here? Or do you have a lot of outside input, I guess, for everybody?
It's really helpful, I think, for us to ask. Because, like, we're so caught... we're so like caught up in what we're doing a lot of times, and like we have such a, I guess, insider view,
right,
that it's really helpful to ask, like, not that they're outsiders at all, but just like a different perspective for them, because when they come to the show, they're watching out front and stuff, and we've never seen a show because we're always on stage,
right?
And so it's just, yeah, and they have really good opinions. So
yeah, and my wife writes as well, and she's kind of an artist as her own self, and so it's helpful for me to kind of hear her ear, because she does not really traditionally, like, she doesn't love folk music, so it's kind of cool to get her input on some stuff too.
So did you know her before the band?
I did not.
So did she like the band earlier?
She did not.
So you couldn't use that as a card?
No. Well, I've tried to play that card. Yeah. You know, initially, but it didn't really work.
They suck, yeah. Now, I did see on your Twitter feed, it said something about dancing like Beyonce. So is that, I mean, is everybody, maybe I'm the only one who doesn't know about it, but is that like a thing with you guys, that that's your thing, or like?
It's Beyonce's thing.
Well, so do you.
We just try to copy what she's doing, you know, with our butts.
Okay.
Yeah, we like to shake it a little bit, not
really?
In this setting necessarily.
Okay. We won't stop you if you want.
But we always have like a surprise, like kind of at our shows. There's like always a moment of weirdness where we feel uncomfortable, but hopefully it just works somehow.
You mean you feel uncomfortable with the crowd, or what do you mean, we
feel pretty comfortable?
Yeah. We make the crowd uncomfortable, I think. That's more what I was trying to say.
Okay, I got you. And as far as the gigs, now you're playing, I mean, you said you would do living room shows, and now obviously you're playing big stadiums, and you've done National, you've done Conan, right? Were you on Letterman too?
We were on Letterman right before you turned retired, yeah.
Yeah. So those kind of experiences I always think are funny because it's like you wait forever and then it goes by quick. Or how were those national TV appearances?
Well, the one thing like about Letterman that I remembered was it was just so cold.
Right.
It was cold in New York City that day, but like the studio was like, he keeps it like 42, or he kept his studio like 43 degrees or something like that. And so as like a young band, this is like our first like shot at like TV or whatever. We're like obviously a little nervous, and you go down in the studio and you get even more nervous because you're like freezing. But yeah, it was just like that. Just like it goes by so quick, like the audience, like you're playing in front of more people than you ever played in front of, but like nobody's actually there in front of you. So you kind of have to like bring your like own energy, but it makes it fun. It's amazing.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, the last song that I'm assuming you're doing, I think, was one that was written kind of, is there a kind of funny origin story to this song that has become so popular?
Yeah, it's actually, it's kind of a funny thing where you're talking about the songwriting process and how it kind of like works for us, but this song, we were actually just kind of rehearsing and jamming off of our first record. We're about to go on tour, and we wrote this song like in probably 2 minutes in like a shed. And it really, like, as a songwriter, because like you sometimes you can kind of like hang on a line for like 3 weeks and it just like bugs you, and then sometimes it's just like somehow a song is just like you can just almost let music be music. And obviously the lyrics in the song are rather simple, and that's on purpose, because it was really geared towards like our live show. Like we have a banjo and mandolin, and the chorus is chanty, and we love people to sing along the songs on our shows. And so yeah, the origin of it was rather simple in of itself. So
that, it seems like that happens a lot. And did you think like, ooh, this is going to be a hit? No.
We all loved playing it. I mean, like you said, we just finished this record and didn't expect to have a new song that we were going to play on tour. But like, wow, this is awesome. We really like the way this feels, and started playing it. And from the first show, I was like, what is this song? Why can't I have it? Like, sorry, we just came out the record.
Oops. Damn.
Yeah, so for about a year and a half, every day we get all these tweets like, where's the song? You can just find this crappy YouTube video. But so we kind of knew from that people
would do it. Yeah. All right, well, let's do it, or you'll do it. We'll chant along. It's Judah on the line.
Yeah, I'm going to do my intro, if that's okay.
Please. Okay. Please.
Well, first of all, I mean, like, we never thought that radio would embrace us, and like what you said earlier actually meant a lot to me. What you said is just like, we thought like kind of being unique and not really sounding like any thing like kind of would be a disadvantage, because just like nobody really, like, especially early on, knew like what to do with us, or like, what are you? You're like so many different things. And in a lot of ways, that was on purpose, because we all have these different influences. We're from different parts of the country. Nate's from Colorado, Brian's from Chicago, me and Spencer are the Tennessee kids. But anyways, it's such an honor to be here and to be playing for you guys in Madison, and be on the radio station here. It's just an unbelievable honor. So thanks so much for having us, and thanks for giving me crap about my intros. But this last song was like really, like the lyrics came out kind of quick, but the heart behind it was kind of redefining what success looked like to us. Maybe you can relate to this in your own field, but we had just finished playing Letterman, or some big thing just happened, and like what you said, it kind of just went by quick. And I kind of found that you're kind of like, if you live for those moments, or if you let stuff like Letterman, or like selling records, or selling more tickets, or whatever, you're essentially never going to be like happy, or never going to be satisfied, because you can always sell more tickets, you can always sell more records as an artist. There's, unless you're like U2 and you can sell as many records as you want or whatever. But so these verses and this courses are about just kind of like taking it all back, to go back to that moment when we started as a band, and the music and our intentions and perspective was really just to make honest music that was life-giving to people, that could hopefully evoke some inspiration for them. So at the end of this song, it's like, we're going to take it all back. We're like waking up to the fact that success is not these certain things that we kind of made it after 2 or 3 years of making money and selling more records. It's about making honest music and taking it all back to evoke inspiration in people's lives and hopefully have some sort of positive impact. So thanks so much for coming. We are playing in Madison, I think March 26th. I'm sure we'll be seeing, hanging with you guys as well, hopefully for that. But is that right? Is that right, Dave? Okay. So yeah, please come see us. We're also playing tonight with 21 Pilots. Is anybody coming to that show tonight?
Sold out, baby.
Sold out. Sorry. next time, though.
It's Judah and the Lion.
This one's Take It All Back. My dreams coming true, and I'm getting to do it with you. It feels so nice when the people sing along, singing along with the banjo. I'm waking up.